Recorded live.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Genesis Science Fiction Radio Show, a service of the Black Science Fiction Society.com website. This is our March 14th, 2014 edition, and our special guest today, my name is William Hayashi, I'm your host. Our special guest today is Jaquetta A. McManus, and she is, would you characterize yourself as mostly a young adult writer, or is it broader than that?
No, definitely young adult, children books.
Okay,
yeah.
Children books. So, she is coming to us from where? Where are you sitting tonight?
I'm in Douglasville, Georgia, right outside of Atlanta.
And what's your weather like?
Nice and breezy.
Okay. All right, and I'm not going to make fun about how you folks lose your minds when you get a little bit of snow because, well, I mean, look, I'm not like other people. I do understand the fact that, you know, Atlanta gets so little snow, and it would cost you, you know, just ridiculous amounts of money to get all the plows and everything if they're only used like every other year or every third year or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But it is kind of fun to watch when you all get a storm.
The city shuts down.
Yeah, exactly. And there's a little bit of jealousy there, too, because here in Chicago, we had like 6 inches of snow a couple days ago, and not only is it gone, it was like 60 degrees today, but the next day, all the streets were open. There's like no excuse up here ever.
Oh, wow.
Not going to work, not going to school. You know, I think we were shut down either 2 days or 4 days this winter because of, you know, really, really bad cold. You know, when it gets so cold that you know, you don't want little kids out there because they'll just freeze. But snow, we got snow down. So, and so we had 60 degrees today. How about where you are?
Oh, yeah, it was in the high 50s, low 60s today. It was really nice. But I do have to defend Atlanta that we have so many hills down here, even when it gets cold, when there's a little bit of ice, you can't even go up them. Like, when we can't go to work just because we can't get out of our driveway, we have a hill.
or when you get out of the driveway, you go down the hill and you can't stop.
You can't stop. It's just hills everywhere in where we live, so it shuts everything down. Everybody goes to the store before it comes, cleans out the stores, and just stays home.
Oh, now that I experienced that for the first time here. I think it was, I don't know if it was December or January, but it was the first time that they were talking about we were going to have really, really Arctic cold here. And I walked over to the store because it was not, you know, it wasn't cold yet. And I swear to God, it looked like, you know, one of those scenes out of the zombie apocalypse where everybody goes in and grabs all the food and hides in their house. I have never seen that at a Chicago grocery store ever in my life. I mean, I'm going in there, and there's, like, no bread, you know.
No eggs. Exactly.
And I just went over there for some soup, and I'm going, and they had taken up all the soup. I mean, people just got crazy, and it was only going to be cold for 2 days.
Yeah.
For 2 days. So, all right, well, let's get back to you. Enough about our weather talk, because nobody really gives a darn about the weather unless it's where they are. But, you know, you write children's books, and let's get started. Like, where did you grow up?
Oh, I grew up in Bowling Green, Kentucky. I never even heard of Bowling Green, but it's right outside of Tennessee, about 45 minutes from Tennessee, Nashville, Tennessee. And so just a small town, you know, country, real small. Everybody knows everybody, you know, very quiet life.
Uh-huh. And you were there for most of your formative years, as they call them?
I was there until I went to college. And when I went to college, I just never moved back. But, yeah.
Yeah. And now, you know, you're a writer now, and we're not going to discuss your age or anything, but, I mean, did you No. I mean, when you were growing up, did you have kind of like that creative imagination for writing, or was that something that came to you later?
Oh, it came much later. I really didn't like English when I was going through school. I remember my English teacher telling me I had a knack for writing, but I just looked at him like he was silly. You know, I didn't like writing stories.
Mm-hmm,
I read
mm-hmm.
a lot. I read a whole lot, but I didn't connect the two. I always knew I loved animation, and I used to collect the Disney movies. And I knew that it was something with that I wanted to do, but actually writing the stories myself never came to me until actually after college. So it came real late.
And were they, did you think that they were kind of like trying to fool you and, oh, you're such a great writer, you should do it more? And you go, no, thank you, I did what I did for my grade, now back off.
They never pushed us. I've always had teachers comment to me about my writing stories,
right?
not grammar. My grammar was terrible, but the actual storytelling, I always got comments on. And I never really liked English, so I really paid them no attention. It was like I wanted, you know, I did my computer classes and stuff and just kind of left the English and the storytelling in the background. Never even really gave it any thought.
Wow.
And
then, okay, so you get through elementary school and then high school. Did you do much writing in high school other than what you had to do for class?
None.
Okay.
If it wasn't for class, I read a lot, and I always remember reading a lot. Like, I can consume a novel in a day, especially if I had nothing to do. But the actual wanting to write my own stories, I had a good imagination, but I never thought there would be stories.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, what were you interested in reading? What genre, what were you, you know, kind of tripped your trigger?
I jumped around, but late in high school, I got into the Danielle Steele books really heavy, which was probably not appropriate.
Okay.
I went through that phase. I did a lot of the fantasy books. Like, I read Never Ending Story. I read a lot of stuff. Like, I just read whatever was interesting. Nothing in particular. No favorite author until I got, you know, Danielle Steele for a while. But then I moved out of that. But I read, you know, just how to pique my interest.
Isn't Danielle Steele, you know, if we were to be honest, kind of considered fantasy too?
Okay, yeah, fantasy romance.
I'm just saying, you know, because I've never had any of those Daniel Steele experiences myself.
Yeah, I can see that.
All right, so you go through all of that time. You're a great reader, okay? You're an avid reader. You know, you're not thinking at all in terms of writing your own stories. And then what kind of breached that threshold for you where you said to yourself, well, you know what? Maybe I could do this, or I don't know, you know, what was your motivation looking at it and saying, you know, I can do better than this, or what happened?
Well, went through college, I got my degree, I had a digital animation degree, so I was really into the animation part of storytelling, and I took my film classes and stuff. I came out of college, I had my first child when I was in college, so I came out, got married, me and my husband moved. We settled, and I was like, okay, let me get into the film side of things. So I shot my first short film, went to the, submitted it for the Atlanta Film Festival, went to court, the Atlanta Film Festival, made the top five, first one, so I thought I was doing good. You know, the people who was with me, who helped me create the short, was like, let's go on and do something with it. Let's go on and start writing it into a series. So we actually started writing it as a series. I got to the third episode, and I was like, I cannot live in drama all day long. It's just not something I want to do. And by this time I had my daughter, she was maybe 3 or 4. And I was one of those mothers who read to my kids every night when they was little. And I was just looking for books to read to her that I enjoy too, a fantasy adventure with a colored female character, and couldn't find them. And that was the trigger right there. Like, I don't want to write dramas all my life. I'd rather write something fun. I didn't see it in the market. And that's where it started.
You know, a lot of people have done, you know, have said the same thing, you know, who I've interviewed, you know, especially comic book creators are a notable larger group, because a lot of them have said to me, you know, one of the things that they noticed when they were growing up was there were no comic book characters, no superheroes, nobody who looked like us. And that was a good motivation for them. A couple weeks ago, I don't know, I'm getting old and I can't remember. You know, I interviewed somebody who said that, you know, his African lore based books were a response to the same thing. You know, he wanted to have stories to read to his children that reflected, you know, people of color, black people. And maybe even, you know, bringing obviously some of the African lore to the forefront. So, I mean, you looked at that the same way, and when you started your, you know, building your creative universes, what were kind, you know, some of the main features and what were the prime move, you know, what was the prime movement of the subject matter of the stories that you started to write?
When I first wanted to come into writing stories, I wanted something that was fun to, you know, a fun world to be in. If you're going to be in it for years, I wanted to enjoy being in that world. And so venture was the first thing. Fantasy adventure was the first thing that popped in my mind. It's like, if I'm going to write, let me write it. Let it be a fantasy adventure. Love fantasy adventure stories. And so and at the time, I always set aside a certain day with my kids to spend time with them. And at that time, my son was into Avatar, the cartoon, you know, The Last Airbender. And so I think it might have been on, like, the second going into the third season. I've been watching it with him all the way out. And I'm like, that's the type of world I wouldn't mind being in. And so when I first started, my first story that actually isn't published came from me watching that, wanting to create a world. This was a fantasy adventure where these characters went on this big adventure on all these different locations, and something that I felt like if I had to be in that world for years, I could be in it and be happy being there. And so the motivation came from, that's why it's children's stories, because it's low drama. So you're not dealing with a lot of the adult drama. You can make it curious, you can make it fun, you can make it adventurous, you can magical, whimsical, and it not, at the end of the day, you can still smile that you're in that world. And so it wasn't so heavy. And so that's how the genre and the age group came to me.
And this was like very shortly out of college, though, right?
I was out of college a good bit. I mean, I think my daughter at the time might have been four. Four or five. So, you know, yeah, shortly after college.
And okay, so you bend your talent to writing after doing movies. You know, let me ask you about the movie you did. You mentioned the movie. And it was a short, you said?
Yeah, it was 15 minutes, a short film.
And what was the subject matter of it?
Choices. It was an adult short film about a woman deciding to whether or not she wanted to keep her baby. It was about choices, her life choices. And so, I mean, it did well, was received well. Got a lot of questions about whether or not it was my choice in life, and it was never my choice in life I had to deal with. But the characters themselves had a lot of complex problems and a lot of drama in their life. And, you know, I wanted to show how, in the short film, how choices affect everything.
Right.
And it was her choice on how she got to where she was at. On the choices she made up to that point led her to the situation she found herself in.
Okay, so. And yeah, and of course, that, I mean, that is pretty heavy. I've helped people produce films like that here, and I would love to see like maybe some comic relief in them or whatever, but you know, a lot of them you can't. You know, when people write them out, and was this something you wrote yourself? Did you write the story, by the way?
I did. It was my first short film I ever wrote, yeah.
Okay. And, yeah, that's kind of heavy material. I can see why you would go, you know, maybe this is not, I mean, where you want to live creatively. But, I mean, it sounds like you did it well, and it certainly was well-received. Would that be fair to say?
Yeah, I could say that, yeah.
Okay. Win any awards?
We didn't. We, of course, were screened at the film festival, but we didn't win. But, you know, I was happy for the first short to be in the top five. So, you know.
That's great. That's great. Okay. So, and for people who are looking for your work, you can go to www.worlds2discover.com, all one word, and two spelled out T-O, www.worlds2discover.com to take a look at your work. When how long did it take you to kind of gin up your first, you know, your first story?
I would say it took me a couple of years. I mean, when I first decided I was going to write, I first actually it got into doing the publishing. I didn't actually think I was going to actually start writing very early. I thought I was going to get into publishing. I wanted to do a magazine. I wanted to do a children's fantasy adventure magazine that came out monthly with five or six short stories of fantasy adventures for kids with artwork in it. And so when I first started, it was called Labyrinth Door, and it was going to be a magazine. And I started getting submissions for stories. I actually started getting the artwork and started getting subscriptions. But I felt like for me coming out, it was just going to be too much to take on. And so I decided instead of doing the magazine, I was switching to start writing my own stories, because I had at that time started writing down my own stories. And I actually started writing a trilogy that was going to be a middle grade book. And as I was writing, I think I got through the first draft, maybe to like 10 chapters, threw it away, started writing it again. And out of that second draft is when I pulled out my first character, Anaya. She's actually part of a bigger story. And I decided to start doing her backstory, which formed into the first story. And so it probably took me about 2 years from when I decided I was going to start Worlds to Discover to where the first book actually came out. And it's called Labyrinth Door, and I Dream of a Warrior, because I wanted to still keep the Labyrinth Door name because I liked it. So I put it on the book.
There's nothing wrong with that. And you know what? A magazine is a very, very hard thing. You know, there's a lot of effort that goes into a magazine because, you know, first of all, in most cases, you rely on a lot of other collaborators or a lot of other people to contribute content. And sometimes it's kind of hard to get all those people together. If you switch over to do a book, you know, it can be a lot more singular. And now your first book is both text and you have illustrations in it?
I do, and color illustrations in the first one.
And who did the illustrations?
Well, two people. Actually, when I first started it, I was working with an illustrator named Maurice Novembre, and he did all the male concept characters. I gave him the ideas of what I wanted them to wear and stuff, and he came out with their look. And then Azure came in, and she actually illustrated the whole book. She used his concept characters for the male, and she did all the concept characters for the females. And then she did, of course, the illustrations and the coloring for it. And so it was a kind of collaboration on that part.
And how, you know, obviously the process of putting it all together, I mean, how did you find your collaborators?
Oh, Craigslist.
Post
on Craigslist. I was looking for an illustrator, and the replies, you know, that was how I found them.
And I mean, like, You found these people kind of out of the blue, your first ones, you got lucky with your first few, or did you have to kind of wade through? You know, because a lot of people have, you know, horror stories about trying to get a collaboration together. Did yours start out very, very, you know, pretty easily?
It did, in the sense that I have a graphic design background. So I'm art director for years. I've been graphic design for years. So I have an eye visually, coming from my animation background and doing graphic design for so many years, to where when I knew, when I saw it, it was a no-brainer for me. You know, and so I didn't have to worry about, you know, I don't have any problems when I see good artwork, whether or not the artist can do the artwork. You know what I'm saying? Because my eye is I can tell whether or not I think they can do it. And so when I saw their emails come through, it was like, okay, you're you and you.
Well, that's great. We've got a couple people here who I don't know if you can see the show chat room, but they're pretty impressed with the artwork that you have on your website. So just letting you know that you at least have some fans on the show here already. So you've got a character, you put together a backstory about her, and did you kind of put together a story arc for multiple volumes? You know, did you want this to have legs and go out, or did you think, you know, like I wrote it, I'm in the finishing up a trilogy, but when I started writing, I thought I had one book. You know what I mean? And then all of a sudden, I figured out, oh well, it's going to be longer. How did you approach it as a multi-volume series?
I always knew it was going to be multiple books. I didn't think it was going to be a trilogy. I still don't think the story that Anaya is coming from is going to be a trilogy. I think it's going to be more than that. But I always came with a major plot arc for the whole series, and then break it down into individual plot arcs for each book, and then of course character arcs. And so I break it down that way. Yeah.
Well, and you know, that almost sounds like a film construction, you know, or a multi, you know,
yeah.
like a TV construction. I don't mean that badly at all. I mean, you know, when you start a TV show, you for damn sure have to have more than one show in mind, because that's obvious.
Right.
But to actually plot it out that way, it's like you got your creative universe, you put your characters together, and now it's time to let them go out and play. When you did your first book, did you find a publisher or did you self-publish?
Oh, it's self-published. It's of course set up Wall Street Discovery. It's a publishing company. Set up as a publishing company, but I put it out. I mean, I found my printer. You know, of course with graphic design, I can do all my layout and stuff. So that was never an issue whether or not how that was going to get done. And I knew how to go to print. So I always knew when I was going to write stories that I was going to go and distribute it myself.
Mm-hmm. And so the first one comes out, and what kind of response did you get from it? And I know, you know, by and large with self-publishing, you don't, you know, because you don't usually have big marketing money, you know, your circle starts out a little small. But I mean, what kind of response did you get from the first, when the first one came out?
I've gotten a really good response from it. From the people who's read it to when I put that one out, and then when I came out with Tamu, people came and bought Tamu because they have the first book, even though they're two different age groups. And so, so far, I mean, I've gotten a really good response. Of course, I've had some people ask me about one of the characters meditating in the book, in Anaya's book. You know, they thought it was kind of religious toned. I didn't feel that way, but I'm like, okay. But, I've gotten letters from people that told me they really like the book. When I go to events, I've received good feedback from it.
I mean, that's great. Right out of the box, you know, that's something. And again, I think that is a testament to, you know, planning out your story well. People have commented that, you know, with your animation background, It shows in the artwork that you've got, which, I mean, it is your book. You do direct the artwork, you know, even if you may not, you know, put pen to paper or anything like that. So, I mean, it sounds like you've done a very, very good job of artistically managing putting a creative universe like that together. When you look at, you know, where you're going to go with this, you know, obviously, you just said that it's going to be more than a trilogy. You're going to probably get more volumes out of it. And you know, with that age group, you know, of the characters you have, it seems like a natural, you know, you can take them through transitions, growing up, passages, you know, all of those kinds of things that kids go through, which when kids read about, also help them feel better about themselves. When you craft your stories, what are some of the things that you consciously concentrate on?
One of the big ones is I want to pique curiosity of kids. I want them to be able to kind of have an escape while they read it to where they feel like they're in the world that anything is possible. That's always in the back of my mind when I'm creating worlds and the characters. I want the female to be strong. I want her to definitely have some feistiness to her, but to be able to not be the damsel in distress. I want her to be able to get up and do what she needs to do to get through. And so I definitely want, I'm very conscious of the main character and her outlook on the world that she's in, always. And so I think that's probably going to be a theme through most of my books. But I'm very conscious of that. But I want the world to be something that if you actually was transported to that world, you would want to be in that world for a while, if it was a physical world.
Yeah, it's like a fantasy setting where people can kind of, where children can lose themselves and also fuel their own imagination. I like the fact that you want to create characters that are, you know, I don't want to say strong women. Let's just say, you know, characters who are not wanting, who are not weak, who are not dependent.
Mm-hmm.
I think that that's a great thing because, you know, kids do absorb those messages. When you write your stories, are you of a mindset where when you're writing, you're able to pull this all together, you know, the nomenclature, the dialogue, all of that, you know, are you able to automatically write in that, you know, that age level or age appropriate level that you want to be in, or do you, you know, have kids read it? I mean, how do you craft, you know, what's the physicality of your craft, the process?
The process is kind of sporadic. It's not I don't have a formula. I always come up with the character first. The character and character name is very important to me to have before I start writing, because to me it's their identity, and that's who I'm building off of, is the character. And so it always starts there.
Yeah, and that drives the story for you, right?
That's a driver for me. And then the world is built around them. As far as the language for this one, since I was already working on another book and another novel, her voice was already there, but her motivation for me wasn't there, which is how I came to start writing her backstory. And it came out of, sometimes I got to a point to where when I don't know, I started journal entries for my characters, writing in their voice and just writing random thoughts. Like if they were sitting down with pen and paper, writing in their journal, what would they write about?
Mm-hmm.
What would they feel? And when I write in the journal, it's always in first person, even though the book is written in third person. And so that helps me develop their personality and their voice. It helps me to understand what in their world they're seeing that maybe writing in third person I'm not seeing. And so I do a lot of that. And so,
go ahead. I think that's brilliant. I mean, seriously, because, I mean, to craft your characters that way, automatically gives them, you know, three-dimensionality. You know, because if you're writing a journal for one of your characters, and yeah, you're writing in first person, and even that the fact that you're telling the story in third person, what you've done is you're crafting a three-dimensional character in a way that is that's very effective and very compelling, you know, especially for kids, you know. In your series, if somebody wants to know, what was the title of the very first volume, the very first book?
For Anaya, it's Anaya, Dream of a Warrior. It's her very first book.
Okay.
The book that she's coming out of, I haven't, you know, finished, so it's not released.
Oh, okay. All right. No, that's some, you know, because I see that you're not logged in, so when I see the questions.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, it's okay if you don't mind me asking them for you.
Okay.
Because, you know, we used to let people, you know, dial in and ask questions later in the show, but that turned into we'll talk later. Okay. So anyway, it sounds like you have a very effective process, and once you've got these journals, once you have these people in your head, I would imagine that the story probably flows better because you have a, you know, in your head, you already have a well-crafted personality and a simulation of the person.
Right.
So once you get started, is it pretty easy? Now you've got your backstory done? Oh, it isn't.
This one is kind of tricky for me because her story has to progress with the novel that she comes out of. So that if you read her storyline, because she has more books to come out, and then you go back to read the novel that she comes out of, they have to, you know, there has to be a correlation there. And so I'm finding myself going back between this book and the other book. And what I've noticed is I've changed the storyline. If I change it in one, I got to go back and change it in the other.
Well,
and
sure.
So
yeah.
It's kind of a crazy process, actually, because I like something that I wrote for. I've written a couple of drafts for Anaya's next book. And I had to kind of let them go and restart her book again because the novel went into a direction I wasn't expecting. And I had to change her to curve with that. And so for her, it's kind of a little bit more harder.
Uh-huh.
And that I have to get the other, you know, I almost feel like I got to finish the other book, the draft of the other book first before I can finish hers because hers keeps changing to coincide with the other one.
Don't you wish sometimes that your characters were a little better behaved and helped you out a little bit more?
Right.
Oh, don't laugh. You're far braver than I am. I mean, you talked about throwing out a whole, you know, 10 chapters.
Oh, I do that several times.
Oh, see, I just, for the first time ever, just a few weeks ago, I threw away, you know, the last three chapters of a book because I didn't like the way it was ending. And it, honest to God, it was one of the hardest things I've ever done. You know, I was thinking about, oh, can I save this? Can I rewrite? Can I do this? Can I do that? And maybe it's because I don't have that much experience that, you know, I just could, it was very hard to let it go. So, my hat's off to you. I mean, it was hard for me.
I think it comes from, I have an art minor.
Right.
You have a digital animation major, you got to have an art minor. And I remember my one of my art teachers, he used to make us go out and buy some of the most expensive paper. And we would come into class and we would spend days on some artwork on our paper. And then he would like, okay, I want y'all to pick it up and tear it up. And you'd be like, huh? Like, are you serious? And he would be dead serious. Tear it up. He said, you can't get attached. He's like, you cannot ever make a masterpiece if you're getting attached to what you're creating now. He's like, only way you can ever get to your peak is to be able to discard. And so I had a lot of practice of discarding. And so if I got, you know, 10 chapters in and it wasn't working, it was easy for me to just like, okay, let's start over.
Man, I wish I would have learned that lesson because it would have made life a lot easier for me, or I would have felt a little better because, you know, it was hard to let go.
Yeah.
Especially, especially if it's something that you've crafted for a while, you know. Okay, so it sounds like you're well on your way. You've got your creative universe. You've got your characters. You've got well thought out characters. You know, you put together three-dimensional kind of profiles of your characters, even to the extent of writing journals about them. But you just mentioned just a few seconds ago that you wish the stories came easy to you.
Mm-hmm.
And why do you think that is when you've got all of this in your head, you know, so planned out? Are the stories difficult to craft or what is the hardest part for you that makes it difficult?
Well, for me, I always, when I've got a process to come up with quick outlines. I can make an outline in minutes, you know, of a story. I have a lot of stories in my head.
Sure.
Actually. And, you know, I always start off with the unknown world, the known world, where the character is at the beginning of the story, and the unknown world, where they're going to end up at the end of the story. And then I can fill in how they get to that, you know, get to those points from one point to the other. I always go from there then to what the major plot of the story is. And then I can pick out what their tribulations and the journey is going to be, what they got to learn, what they got to overcome. So that part is really easy. That never changes. But the details and the world changes as the character progresses because when they're going to new locations and they're learning new things that I didn't expect in them to learn in an outline, it shifts the story and it shifts the tone. And I got to decide what tone am I going to stick with? Am I going to go dark? Or am I going to stay light? Am I going to go into this, you know, it shifts. So for me, it's the balancing act of it that's the most difficult part. The overarching story never changes, but the details and the world building is constantly changing.
Mm-hmm.
And so that for me, and maybe I've had one of my friends who's been writing, she went to school for writing, and I met her because she was my roommate in college. And she's like, you just make it too big. You're making your world too big. You know, condense them down, but I can't condense them down. It's just like, it's in my head. And so I'm
right.
Trying to get the balance of what is actually going to be shown in the book. because I have notebooks, literally notebooks of backstory of some of these characters and worlds and things that's going to be in the world. And it's there. I just got to be able to bring it all together.
Yeah,
and so that's
the
balancing act.
One of the things that I did was when I started writing, I read books on being a novelist by a American writer named John Gardner, and a couple of his books on writing were so helpful because they pointed out things to me that I never thought of. You know, I came to writing late. You know, I was in my 40s when I started writing my first book, and you know, and that's late. I never thought of writing. Well, okay, way back, like when I was a slut DJ, I was going to write a book about dating mate. Well, I'm just being honest. It was the 70s, and it was going to sell on the title alone. And I'm going to give the title away if anybody wants to write it, because you'll sell your book on the title alone. And it was called It's Great When You Find One That Fits. But I had no idea how to write a book, you know. And there is craft that goes into it that I've since learned. And I think I ran into the same problem that you do. There was so much that I knew that was part of the story or part of the world. And it seemed like I needed to put all of that in there to make the story right. But one of the lessons that I learned was if a particular paragraph, sentence, whatever, subplot, whatever, does not move the story along, it doesn't belong in the story.
Right.
That's a tough one for me to follow even now, because I'm pretty wordy. have you studied the art of writing to any extent, or do you just come by it naturally?
Oh no, it's a study. I decided that when I was going to go, this was going to be my career, this was going to be my passion, this was going to be my love, that I would be studying until the day I die. I'm always studying storytelling. And I don't look at it as studying writing so much. I understand that writing is a part of the storytelling in this process, but I also plan on making these into movies, so I need to know how it's going to convey in writing as well as in visual on the screen. And so I study storytelling. I will listen to commentaries. I used to watch movies, and then after the movie, write down my review of what I would change about it to make it better. What works and what, you know, how do you make somebody fall in love with a character? I used to just, that would be one of my questions, and I would go and just start researching, watching movies to try to figure out, okay, what makes that character so lovable? Why do you hate that character? I study I'm always constantly studying storytelling. I love Netflix for it because I can sit and watch a whole series and see the arc from beginning to end and completely understand how the characters moved and changed throughout without having to wait weeks in between, you know, over years to watch a 4 or 5 series, part series. So, I always constantly study storytelling.
So, I mean, and already you have a goal of committing these to film, correct?
Oh, yeah, animation, absolutely.
All right, so you return to your roots, when you talk about taking the stories that you've got now, how many books out do you have out right now?
I have actually published 2 books and 1 coloring book.
Okay.
Actually written and edited. I have another book that had been written since last year that's completely edited and ready to go. Just the illustrations aren't ready. And some other drafts that I just need to get edited. So, but published 2 in 1 coloring book.
And how far down the line do you think it's going to take you to start, you know, animating your work? Is this something that soon, later, once you have a few more volumes under your belt, what do you think your plan is?
Well, for Anaya, it's going to be a while, but my second book, Tuli, which is for a smaller age group, 4 to 8, I've already started animating her in promos just to get a feel of getting her animated. So she already has a short promo out, and it's 20 seconds. It's not much, but I'm already looking to do more just so I can get a feel of her in animation. So hopefully sooner than later. Yeah, I'm already thinking about it. I already got her theme music, which I love, and hopefully this year we might even have an IS theme music done just to get it in my head. Starting to build it.
Do you use any writing tools? right now, or do you write out your stories longhand? You know, what kind of trade craft do you employ in your writing?
I do both. I will go to notebooks if I don't. I go to notebooks to write, especially like, early reader chapter books, because I can't edit. I won't edit longhand. I just won't do it. I'll edit it when I start typing it. But I also use software. One of my favorite was for a long time was Write It Now, because it was cheaper and it was easy. But now I'll switch from Write It Now and I'll jump into like Pages for I have a Mac, so I'll jump into Pages and write it. And seems to, so it just depends on what my feel is. I'll make it an ebook and then put it on my iPad and I'll edit it while I'm reading it, because it reads differently when you're reading it on a device versus when you can edit it on screen. And so I do a lot of different things. It just depends.
Yeah, so I mean, it sounds like you've got, I mean, in your process, you have an array of tools that are most effective for different phases of how you're going to write, right?
Right, yes. I would say that, yes.
Well, people always want to know, you know, do you use this tool, do you use that tool? I mean, people are astounded that I use WordPerfect instead of Word. But WordPerfect has absolutely. See what I'm saying? You know, people go, you don't use Word? I go, no, I don't use retarded programs. And then they go, you're not supposed to use the word retarded. I said, I'm using it in the book form. But the fact of the matter is, you know, everybody uses different tools, and once you get used to them, a friend of mine who is also a member of the SFS, Natasha Womack, she's finishing up another book, and we were working on it, and there were some features in WordPerfect that she could have used, you know, like drop capitals and, you know, just stuff that makes putting a book together easier, and those features are in the program I use, and they're not in, you know, Microsoft's product. So, I mean, it's just a matter of what people get used to. You know, I'm kind of old-fashioned, too, you know, being as old as I am. No, seriously, I went to Dirt's first birthday, but let's flash forward ahead. When you think in terms of doing your animation, what kinds of tools do you use, you know, for, or do you even know what you're going to be using when you get to that point?
For animation, I'm not going to physically animate. I realized in animation classes that I was not going to be an animator.
Okay, so you'll be farming that out.
I love the directing part of it. I love editing it, but I don't want to sit down to actually do keyframes and I won't actually be the animator, but I do want to, you know, produce and direct it. And so I know that that's going to be a process. I would love to one day go and get, you know, 2D hand-drawn animations done, which I don't know if I'll ever get to that, but there's some programs out there that, you know, I like Toon Boom. I like, I know people still use Flash. And anime, you know, it's a couple of programs I could see it being done in.
Sure. So. Well, and you know what? You know, when you put your team together, they'll use the tools that they're most effective with anyway.
Yes. Yeah. And so, yeah.
You're not far off. It sounds like you're not far off from getting to that point. And let's talk about the kind of like the business side of doing this. Let's talk about marketing, because a lot of people want to know how to get their work out there. What are some of the ways that you bring attention to your work?
When I first got started, I realized the blogs, doing the virtual book tour through the blogs is really helpful. Some of them are really great. That was really good. Now that I'm doing that, and most people, when my second book came out, also, you know, they'll mention it and whatever. That was really doing well for me. But now when I do events, I'm actually getting calls from out of state for events now. And people send me letters to want me to come to do, you know, to bring my books. I've noticed that libraries are really good, because the last event I did at the library, the director came and talked to me, and, you know, she wants to talk about my books getting into the library system. So I'm realizing they are a big help. I'm so glad I got connected at the libraries in my area, because they're willing to help you. You know, they like the book and they're willing to help you. And so I think both, their word of mouth has made a difference for me, and me doing the virtual blog tours has been doing very well for me too.
And are you in touch with a lot of your fans, you know, electronically? Do people take the time to write to you and, you know, want to talk about or express, you know, their admiration for what you do or even give you suggestions?
Not through, because I have a very young, you know, 4 to 8 year olds is to me her age range. So you really, the fans have to be the parents, you know. And,
well, that's what I meant. I meant the parents. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Yeah. But I get some feedback. Some people contact me through, you know, Facebook or whatever. But I've noticed a lot lately when I do events, people just come and just want to talk. I'm at an event trying to sell books, and they'll just want to talk. We'll end up talking about different shows and stuff. So I don't know. I don't really get a lot of contact through the social media. I get some, but I don't get a lot. Like if I go on Twitter and stuff, there's definitely some people that always retweet whatever I post, but I don't get a lot of conversation back. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And, well, how long has it been since the first book was out?
The first book came out in 2010.
Well, you know, four years, even though it seemed, I mean, obviously, as the writer, it can seem like a long time. But, you know, like I said, when you self-publish, it's awfully hard to try to manifest that marketing muscle that it gets your name out there, you know, in a lot of different places. But to draw that kind of attention from librarians or library associations, I mean, that's a good thing. I think that's a great thing because obviously they see value in your work for children. Mm-hmm. And that's, I mean, that's what you were shooting for, you know?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How many tours, how many events do you kind of go to nowadays? How often?
Well, because I haven't came out with a new book, I think I might have went to 3 to 4 last year, not very many, maybe 5,
okay.
Just because I want to wait until I come out with new books. I'm like, I don't want to keep going back with the same book.
To the same well, yeah, right.
And I'm also wanting to make sure that next time when I go, like, I had a big cutout of my Talib character, so the kids love it. I mean, they'll want to come by and give her high fives and stuff. And so now... I want to, when I go back, I want to have all my characters in big stand-up cutouts and have them backdrop and stuff. So I'm wanting to, when I go, I want to have it redesigned to where it looks like when you're coming up to something along with new books. So, I haven't really pushed last year. I really didn't push. I probably won't really push this year too much to go into events. There might be one in Alabama I'll go because the lady keeps calling me to come, and I didn't go last year. And
Does she pay you to go?
Oh, no, they want you to come, but they don't. Yeah, I'm not.
I was just asking, because I had someone ask me, you know, well, we want you to come to this Afrofuturism thing. And I said, okay, you know, where are you booking my tickets and where are you putting me up and stuff? I went, well, no, we just wanted you to come, you know, you just stop by. It's like, yeah, like I'm going to be in the neighborhood in Atlanta all the time, you know, with this ankle bracelet. So. Okay, yeah, but I mean, it's nice to be wanted, but it's even nicer if that wanting manifests itself in somehow helping you get there, you know?
Yeah, it's okay.
One of the things that I would like to see, though, if you don't mind doing it, is, you know, when you do go on appearances and things like that, please post up in the BlackScienceFictionSociety.com's events calendar. So that people, you know, and I say this to everybody, you know, if a weekend is coming up and somebody doesn't know what to do or they, you know, maybe they've got some disposable income, if they look on the calendar and say, oh, look, she's going to be here at such and such, you know, maybe I can bring the kids, blah, blah, blah. At least that way there's the opportunity for people to find you and a little bit of exposure. So if you think about it.
Okay.
If you're going to go someplace, definitely post it up so that we could have other people find out where you are.
Definitely.
So, you know, it sounds like you've got a pretty compact universe. You've got a very, very good excuse me, you've got a very, very good kind of business model surrounding, you know, the work that you do. Right now, is it just a matter of getting more work out there so that you kind of broaden, you know, broaden your offerings and things like that? Or, you know, do you think you're going to be maybe introducing a new facet of your universe? How do you see the next little bit going?
Well, it's, one of the reasons why it took so long is because when I came out with Talie, I inked that book. Brian Hardison did all the sketches to your color the cover, but I inked all of it. You know, I inked it. And I had a lot of my friends really come to me and it's like, why am I working for illustrators? They didn't understand why I went to school for digital animation, had an art minor, and I went doing my own drawings. And so that got me to thinking, okay, maybe I can do my own drawings. And so I really stopped. And it's like, okay, I got to get caught up in illustration. I haven't did it in years. Haven't drew. You know, I went and I bought sketchbook after sketchbook until I got, you know, pretty good sketching again. Then, you know, got my husband to buy me the Cintiq. It's like, if I'm going to really do this, I got to have a Cintiq. So he got me the Cintiq. And so for the last year, I've really just been building up my skills on illustration, so when I come out, everything will be illustrated by me.
Wow.
And so I'm at a point, that's why I have books that's written and edited, but no illustrations completed yet, because I'm going to now illustrate everything, which opens up a whole new world to me, because as you illustrate, you find new things about characters, you find new worlds, and so it really, I think, it's going to gel well once I get going again.
Right, and the other thing about that is, you know, nothing gets lost in translation. You know, but if you're doing your own illustrations, excuse me, shame on you if it doesn't look the way you want it to look.
Right.
You know, because I got lucky. I can't draw very well at all. I can only put maybe two or three fingers on a hand before something goes horribly wrong. And now I understand Picasso a lot better now than I did when I first started seeing his artwork, because sometimes you forget and you don't leave enough room for the nose, so you put it on the other side of the eyes. But that's just me. You know, that's just
right.
My talent. You know, that's my skill set. But that's kind of cool, because, you know, when you look at on the website, and for people who are tuning in later, it is www.worlds2discover, and two is spelled out, worlds2discover.com. You can take a look at some of the sample art and find out more about the work. I mentioned that for people who check this out as a podcast later, because they don't see what we're typing in the chat room now.
Okay.
But, I mean, do you think that your style, the style that you're going to be drawing, is going to be very, very similar to what's already been, or are you... Do you think that you're going to, you know, manifest a whole new style and a whole new look? It would seem that the consistency would be kind of a good thing, but I don't know what your plan is. How are you going to move forward?
I'm definitely developing my own style. I think it will be in the same style as the other books, in that they're going to be full color, you know, characters,
right,
and stuff. But of course, it's going to have my own style bent to it. But yeah, I think it's. Of course, my books are not going to look like the previous books. I just don't draw like they do. You know what I'm saying? They
sure,
you know, sure have been drawing for it.
No. I understand. But,
time.
I mean, you know, sometimes when you have a character,
mm-hmm,
you know, that's already been fleshed out visually,
oh, mm-hmm,
sometimes it's kind of hard to change that, you know?
There's going to be some minor changes. Mm-hmm, but
yeah,
her look is going to be consistent. Like, I've actually drawn some stuff of her that I don't think people realize it was my work. And not, you know, the illustrator who originally drawn it, you know, did the drawing. And so
sure,
the characters I want to keep the same.
Uh-huh.
As far, you know, I want to keep them consistent and then just build on it. But, yeah.
Well, you've got that whole big universe that you have not explored visually yet, so that, you know, once you bring things out to the forefront, you're going to own them right away, because they'll be your initial illustrations. It'll be your concept. And so, where are you in your in your skills building for drawing?
I don't know if you, we was on a website, if you saw Ava Brooks in pink. I did a character, her name is Ava Brooks, and she got on a pink shirt. I put, like, Ava Brooks in pink. That's where I'm at now.
Okay.
If you go in, right on World to Discover, she should be on the, you know, right at the beginning, at the front of the page, Ava Brooks.
Okay. All right.
I did. That's mine. That's completely mine.
Okay.
And so that's kind
very,
of what my
very
style
nice.
Is going to
yeah.
be. That's kind of what my style is going to be.
Uh-huh. And then, but then, and so that kind of begs the question, you know, you mentioned that you're going to get animators to do your work. Are you going to have, you're obviously have them work off of your existing art, correct?
Yeah, what I found from doing the promo,
mm-hmm.
I'll probably be more comfortable doing like a detailed character sheet of all the poses and expressions that the character's going to have doing whatever piece we're doing. And doing
right.
the basics of the landscape and the background, and then giving them
mm-hmm.
giving them that to animate with, because
okay.
it's not going to be hand drawn. It's most of it's going to be, you know, a Toon Boom type, you know, where you build, you got the character and you attach a skeleton to it to make them, you know, move and stuff. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and there are so many tools out there, so many digital tools to help you nowadays, that you know, a lot of people just work digitally. They don't even start from hand drawings anymore.
Yeah, right.
So when you, as you embark on creating this empire, you've done well up till now. It can only get better. And no, I believe so. I mean, from what I've seen, it can only get better. How much more time are you going to spend in this world, and do you have other creative universes that you think you're going to be jumping into?
Hopefully have her book series done. It would be nice to stay in the next 4 years. I have her complete, like I have the next 3 or 4 books lined up for her.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully, you know, I stay four years, I should have a nice series for her. Anaya, I want to go on and get hers, might be 3 to 4 books, and then I'm going to let the novel take off, you know what I'm saying? Because we'll see more of her in the novel than you will, you know, more of her when the novel comes out that she comes from. But
right.
I got maybe, I've already started maybe 10 stories, 10 different worlds. One is actually, 2 of them is with a male character, which everybody's like, when are you going to come out with a book with a boy character? I mean, I've got them in my head. I've got the world. I've
uh-huh.
got some of the concept characters for one of them already done. So, it's there. I just got to get it out, you know. So.
Well, I mean, you know, it yeah. first of all, it takes time, and second of all, you don't want to rush, you know,
right.
because the rushing often can ruin something that can, I mean, that's really doing well. excuse me. Once you get these series done, I can't see why this won't be a success in schools and libraries and things like that, because it's perfect for our kids, you know, mm-hmm. to see adventures with people who look like us.
Mm-hmm.
Do you, and I know it may be early, and I know you've got, you know, your own. But do you do any outreach to children or anything like that at this point, or is that going to come later?
Well, I'm starting within the next week or so. I will be teaching a class at a music studio who's starting an art program to where I'm going to be teaching how to illustrate and write your own books.
Mm-hmm,
and so
mm-hmm.
in that sense, I'm going to be directly working with kids in this age
mm-hmm.
group, which I think is going to be perfect for me, because I'm going to learn a lot just from, you know, working with kids on their own stories. And right now, that's as much as I do. I mean, I'll have, every once in a while, I'll do at a bake shop. I know an owner who owns a bake shop, and we'll set up a coloring page day where you come in. I'll bring up coloring pages and crayons, and parents can come in and color with their kids. But right now, pretty much all I do. I don't really have anything where I go out yet and just work with kids.
Yeah. Hang on a second. You're listening to the mm-hmm. Genesis Science Fiction Radio Show, a service of the Black Science Fiction Society.com website, And this is the March 14th, 2014 edition. And our special guest, you can actually check out her work. Let me give you where you can look at her work, is www.worlds2discover, spell all the words out. And it's Chiquita A. McManus. And other than your website, are your books available? Are you seeing them in the libraries? You know, have they gotten to that point where you're in the libraries or maybe at schools? Or are we still kind of early on in that?
Still early on. It's still going to be, I'm waiting for the order to come through.
Yeah, checks
in
the mail.
I don't know what their process is. But, you know, when I talk to the director, she's like, her goal is just to be able to send me one big order and get it in this region.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm waiting for the order.
Yeah. Have you done any readings with children yet?
I have. I did a couple of readings at some bookstores.
How'd those go?
They went well. You know, I make it, when I do events, I want it to be fun. I don't want it to be all about me reading to kids. So we'll set up a table. We'll have pages where they come and they can color. We have cupcakes. They come through the door. I'm giving them gold bracelets. I'm making it like a little, you know, event for them. And so it goes well because everybody's happy.
Well, yeah.
You know?
Wait a minute. You mentioned cupcakes?
Mm-hmm. Say cupcakes.
When's your next one?
Listen, I don't know, but that's a good. You know, one of my characters, Flea, in her book, one of her favorite things is puffy muffins. And I know
okay.
a lady who owns a bake shop, so we make puffy muffins to take to the bookstore for the reading. And so the kids
that's
love
pretty
it.
Cool.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sure. And let's talk about some of the people around you. You know, you mentioned children. You mentioned a husband. Is your family fairly supportive of what you're doing?
Oh, my daughter loves it. My son, he loves art, so he loves it. And my husband completely supports me because he's a music producer, so he understands wanting to put out your own product. And so one great thing about him is that, you know, when I do want to go, this eventually will go to audiobook. I want to do an audio drama, not an audio book per se, but audio drama, to where I can go downstairs into the studio and we can record it. So, and he's like, anytime you're ready, let's go. And so he's real supportive of it.
So what is he like voice talent now, or are we talking about you being the voice talent?
No, my daughter. She's old enough to do the voice, yeah.
Okay, I was going to say, look at this. It's almost like you're starting a family business.
In a sense that I can go to my husband to get him to work, do work for me, yes, but other than that, he'll go to the events, but he has nothing to do with the actual, you know, the production of the books themselves. He supports, but he's like, you know, he does, you know, he has his music thing going, so he's kind of all consumed with that. And so, but, you know, I think my daughter, when she gets older, I think it's something she's going to gravitate to.
Now, has she shown any signs of wanting to create her own stories, you know, to be like mom?
Both of my kids have written their own books before. My son actually wrote his own comic book called Sith Wars, and after he wrote it, we actually painted it on his walls. And so they've both written stories before and illustrated them.
Uh-huh. And so it sounds like, you know, they're at least interested enough, you know, with your example, that they kind of want to follow in your footsteps. Maybe, maybe not.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah,
comics
try
are.
It, yeah.
Yeah, comics are pretty cool because, you know, they're very accessible to kids, especially boys. And I don't mean to be sexist about that, but I mean the demographics bear that out. And if he's interested in becoming a storyteller, that's one of the quickest ways for him to get his stories into the hands of other people.
Mm-hmm.
And start building a name for himself and things like that. So that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
And how old are your son and your daughter?
My daughter's 11, and my son will be turning 15 next month. So. Yeah.
Mm. how is he at 15?
I must say, I mean, he's a really really laid back. He's doing good. I mean, he's really into his sports. He's a freshman in high school, and he just made the varsity track team, so he's all ecstatic about the fact that, you know, he's really doing good in track. Last year, he, you know, was first in the county for the long jump, and so he's really pushing his sports his sport. So as long as he's involved in his sports, you know, he's really got to focus. I'm really happy, you know. I'm good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very cool. You teach the one class, right, that you mentioned?
I will be. I will start.
Yeah, you will be teaching like this.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Do you think you have kind of an affinity for maybe, you know, doing something more formal teaching, you know, along the road, or is that not really of interest as, you know, something to take up?
I think no, probably not formally.
No.
I think I'm a light working with the kids, and it's, you know, because it's short sessions, you know, 8 to 10 week sessions, 2 hours a week. I think I'll be content with that. I don't think I've gotten to where for a while people used to send me their books and want
mm-hmm.
me to read it and critique and, you know, over story, not, you know, grammar, but critique
right.
it as far as the story was. And I found out probably after the course of this one that I did that was not something I want to do all day for a life, you know, for a career.
Yeah. Yeah, I gave up teaching because the damn kids, they got germs. And they got,
oh, no.
I'm serious, they got kid germs. And people, I mean, you listen to you laughing, that's just wrong. You know, when you get above a certain age and you get some of those kid germs in you, those kid germs are pretty virulent.
Yeah.
I'll tell you a quick story. I used to, before I had kids, I would say about every third year, I would get pneumonia. I don't know what it was.
Oh, wow.
I just would get it. And
mm-hmm.
then I had kids, and I put them in daycare. You know, so they're around other kids.
Mm-hmm.
And for my daughter, for the first year, I was sick as a dog for that whole year. You know, flu, cold, this, that, the other thing. But having gone through that, seriously, it kicked up my immune system something. I mean, it was great. And the first time, you know, my daughter was, you know, she's like 16 now. So the first time I got sick was last year. Last year at this time, I had the flu for a month. I've never had the flu for a month. So I, you know, I volunteer at a school, but I volunteer when the kids are like at chapel or when the kids are not at the school. I'm very good at showing up on holidays and doing my work because I don't want any of those germs. But so, you know, I understand you laughing, but there's a good reason for that. Because I'm old. You know, I'm really old. I'm serious. My years are not like people years. My years are more like dog years. And so I'm, you know, even though I'm about 84, I feel about 184. But, I mean, I understand, you know, wanting to stick with your writing. I mean, not everybody wants to teach. Not everybody wants to do that sort of thing. And it, you know, with the kind of work that you do, it's good, you know, I think it's good that what you want to do is you want to continue on and create more and bring more of your stories to kids, and they're kid friendly, and parents are going to love them, you know, as
mm-hmm.
they discover them. So I don't blame you. You know, I just asked about the teaching thing, but the fact is, it seems like you have enough of an awareness of where your stories want to go that you're going to be pretty creative for a very long time.
Yeah.
Do you think that this is something that eventually is going to, you know, I mean, do you consider this a full-time job at this point, being a writer and a creative like this?
Yeah. I mean, I left my job to do this. This is what I'm going to do. I was working, you know, doing graphic design, and I was going to work just hating to be there. And I turned to my husband, like, I can't do this. If I got one life, I want to be happy. And this is not
mm-hmm.
going to make me
mm-hmm.
happy. And I was like, I left, and, you know, he supported me. And this has been what I've did since I left 4 years ago, you know. And so I've, you know, worked, you know, this teaching the kids is going to be my first official job for, you know, since I left my job. And
mm-hmm.
so, and this is only part-time. So, yeah, this is it. It's got to work. This is it.
And so, you know, let's talk about the business of doing business. When you are, I mean, you're self-published, which means you're a publishing company for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Do you do fulfillment for yourself, or do you have a print-on-demand house that does your work? You know,
sends
out your books and things like that.
No, I go to a printer to get it, you know, so so many copies printed out. Yeah.
Yeah, but then you're the one who does, you know, payments and delivery and
mm-hmm.
mailing and what.
Yeah, I do all the shipping and
handling. You do the whole thing. Okay, so.
Yeah. Although I'm thinking about changing it because of a new site that I found. I don't know if you've heard of Ingram Spark. Have you heard of that?
No, I have not.
They just started, and it looks like they have a really nice distribution program for small publishers.
Mm-hmm,
the
mm-hmm.
cost, you know, you can still get your books printed as if you went to a print house, you know, however many copies you want, and they still distribute it to, you know, they put it in the magazines to be for other bookstores and stuff to pick it up. And so I'm really,
oh, that's
really
very good.
Yeah, I think it's something that just came out, so.
Yeah, maybe that's another thing that you could maybe drop a little blog post at BSFS about.
Okay.
You know, about the service, because, you know, obviously there's a lot of people there. I'm a writer. I would love to read about it. And
mm-hmm.
and the more we pass these things along and support each other, I think the better off we are.
Okay.
Excuse me. So that would be here. I can look it up. What was the name of it again?
Ingram Spark. Ingram Spark.
Okay. All right. I'll find it now. But go ahead and post up something on it. That would be great.
Okay.
Is there anything else in your creative universe that you would like to talk about so that people could learn a little bit more about you?
Just from my point of view of storytelling, because I've noticed, of course, since I started writing, I've got a circle of people who also write, a circle of friends who are writers, and we'll have meetings or they come together so we can help each other. And we talk about world building. For some reason, I guess world building for me isn't as difficult because I see in images. I think it must be because I went to animation school and we had to see visually first before we can tell what we wanted to see on the screen.
Sure.
And so when I write books, I see it in my head. I actually see the world. I actually see the characters, see the lights, I see the tone.
Mm-hmm.
I see it in my head. And I have a friend who has a real hard time with world building for whatever reason. And what I always tell her is that, you know, once you have your location and stuff, and once you understand where your character is in the world, the way you put world building in your writing is to have the character interact with that world, have them touch the environment, have them feel the environment, not describe the environment. You know, I never like books who describe the world to me. I want to
mm-hmm.
experience the world through the character. And that's one easy way to build world building into your story. And so I always tell people that world building is easy. Just look at it as you're bringing the world to the reader through the character's interaction with the world that they're in. And so just thought I'd throw that out there, just in case anybody, you know, wanted, you know, world building, another way of looking at world building.
Yeah, I mean, some people, I mean, I think there are probably as many processes as there are writers.
Oh, yes.
Because, you know, some people will get their characters in their heads and something that their character is going to do, and then they'll build the world around the characters, or they'll do it in the reverse way that you just described. I think that, you know, there has to be consistency, obviously. I mean,
mm-hmm.
you can't write a story and then, you know, things go along, and then, you know, at the climax, at the end, all of a sudden somebody pulls a magical something out of their hat that didn't exist
mm-hmm.
in the whole story, and they go, yeah, ta-da, you know, and that's how they end the story. Excuse me, that's a pretty cheesy and generally unsatisfactory way of building a world.
Mm-hmm.
But building a world, I mean, for you, yours is a little bit different than maybe a lot of people in science fiction, because your world is not so intricately different. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I mean, would you consider your world to be kind of, I mean, where does it sit in terms of modern today? Is it earlier? Is it later? Is it now? Is it divorced from the current culture and slightly apart from it? How do you describe it?
Well, both Anaya and Talese, where I would say it's apart from our world. It's really no technology in their world. Talese lives on a gas planet, so she doesn't even have land like we have land. She has to fly to different land masses. And so their worlds are, to me, I don't look at it as in comparison to our world in the sense of if I had to pick where their world fit, I'm not going to the past or the present. I look at it as this universe has a lot of, billions of different planets on it. And if I had to pick a planet where they live, what kind of properties would that planet have? And how would they live in that environment? It's kind of how I see it. So I don't look at it as far as that, but I feel like they're part. I think Anaya's story is probably the closest to, to ancient history as far as some of the things that's going to go on in her story, because they don't have cars and nothing. They're not going to get around with cars and trains and buses and stuff. So I don't know. I feel like they're apart. I don't compare the two.
It sounds like that the way you introduce the world, the way you introduce the creative universe or your universe that you created, is through contextual clues, rather than talking about, they live on a very large tree in this mystical world. I apologize. Sometimes I forget. I have people go, you are so black, and I tell them, but I got a Japanese last name, and they're just not convinced. No, they're not. Apparently, and some of them say, you ain't fooling nobody. But seriously, for you, it sounds like your visual style tells the story through contextual clues about the universe, so that people pick up the flavor of the surroundings, the culture, and things like that through context, rather than exposition. And that seems to be, first of all, that's much more highly visual. Rather than saying, he was driving a red car down a busy street, I just said car, even though you said there's no cars in your book. But for you, it's describing why the action is going on and maybe why that character was doing what they're doing in the context of the people around them, rather than trying to explain, Asimov was good at explaining how the world is. For people to visualize, the foundation, why did we have a foundation, blah, blah, blah. I think you have a more humanistic way of conveying that same information, which makes it more accessible to the kids, because kids are, they're action oriented. They want to know why things are happening. Why are they doing that? They're not interested in the architecture. They're not interested in the basis for the religion or anything like that. They want to know, why is so-and-so doing such-and-such to whom, So, right. It really sounds like you've got a really great grounding in storytelling. do you think that this came from all of the reading you did, or have you grown into it by, your constant study of storytelling? How much of this do you think is nature and how much might be nurture?
I think the natural storytelling came from me just reading and watching a lot of movies. I think the details and the craft of it came from the study, because when I decided I was going to do this, I literally got out a notebook, a three-ring binder notebook, and I started writing down the questions I needed to know about storytelling, literally. And I went on a search to find out how to answer those. I wanted to know, and then you come up across, there's emotional arcs to the story, which a lot of people might not think about. Like, you cannot have, to me, in your story, the highest emotion at the beginning of your story, because that would be the highest they ever get throughout the story. So it has to be by the climax, And if you got to have a high emotion, then your lowest emotion has got to be somewhere near it, because you got to drop them. And then you got to bring them back up. You got to have time to bring them back up to least level, not before the end of the story. So all of those types of details, the craft of it, came from the study of it. the actual just the feel of the story came from me just reading and writing, not reading, I mean not writing, but reading a lot and watching a lot of movies. So I think it's a combination of both of them. But I really, really sat and dissected movies and did, was the emotional high get a climax, or did they give me emotionally high at the beginning and left me hanging for the rest of the movie? You know what I mean? Did I ever get back there? And so I look at storytelling in that way when I actually look at the whole arc of a story, which came from me actually studying story visually and in books.
And do you still do you think you read as much now as you read, you know, back like during your earlier years, or is it, do you have less time to do it, or do you not read as much so that you're not influenced by other things that you read? I mean, where are you at in terms of, you know, your continuing pleasure in the art of reading?
I read a lot for study. I audio read novels now, because since I'm getting into drawing, I can be working on a drawing for hours. I can put on an audio book while I'm drawing and not be distracted by the audio book but still hear the story. So I'm not wanting to turn and look at the TV or anything, because I can't draw, you know, I don't work with the TV on. So the audio book is a good way to consume a book without actually having to read it and not having to stop to turn a look or whatever. But reading the words, I do a lot of reading for study. Like, I'll read books on writing, I'll read books on art. I read to study, but I listen to a lot of audiobooks now to get the story arcs and stuff. So.
And when the audiobooks, are we talking fiction here?
Yes. I mean, I'll do some bios. Steve Jobs is definitely one. You know, James Cameron. You know, I'll read on certain people.
Sure.
But for the most part, it's fiction.
Yeah, and what kind of fiction do you like right now?
Books to go to movies. Just because I want to see what they're leaving out of the books when they go into movies. What stories, how is the story changing? I want to dissect the transition. So, you know, I was the person who read the Harry Potter books, but when the movie start came out, I listened to all the audiobooks so I can get reacquainted with the material, so that when I went to the movies, I wanted to compare. You know, same thing with Hunger Games. I read the trilogy. Now I'm in the Divergent trilogy because I know it's going to come out in the movies, and I want to know the differences. So now, if it's a movie going to come out of it, I want to know about it, I want to hear it so I can go watch it and then compare.
To see how they executed the conversion from novel form to motion picture.
Yeah, because that's what I'm going to have to do with my book. I got to take the words into visuals, and I want to see how effective it's been done before. Yeah.
Yeah. And so what are you finding in your studies? You know, as you have listened to the audiobooks and then gone and seen the movies. What are the attributes that are most noticeable when people do these kinds of conversions or adaptations? Excuse me, not conversions, but adaptations.
I think it's most effective because in the movies, what's very effective in the movies is, well, visually, of course, you know, certain visuals you can't bring out in a book in words, but some of the elements of storytelling, like surprises and stuff, is more effective in movies. I mean, in books, I can kind of see them coming. Movies, you can hide it a little bit better, for me anyway. That's one of the biggest things. It's just how you flip it. I don't necessarily like sometimes when they take out full storylines from a book, you know, for the sake of movie length.
When they have to take out a full subplot that you found.
Yeah.
Enjoyable in the movie, but then all of a sudden enjoyable in the book, but all of a sudden it's absent from the movie because
it's
difficulty. Let's be honest. Today moviegoers are less critical about story. They just are. You know, you look at the highest grossing movies we've had. Just in the past 10 years, okay, some were based on books a lot of them are based on comic books. And nowadays, you know, they don't require any cognition for a moviegoer to watch them at all. You know, as a matter of fact, they try to stay away from that. They don't want people to have to work too hard, you know, so they make the story as accessible as possible, either by, you know, I don't know, destruction porn, or, you know, where they just blow things up and kill people and stuff like that. Or just something where visually you don't have to do anything, you know, because so much is happening on the screen, you can be a passive observer. What kinds of trends have you been kind of looking at? I mean, let's talk about, you know, how they did the conversion of the Harry Potter books or even the Hunger Games. What are the big things you're noticing about how Hollywood is doing these adaptations?
I absolutely think they've been watered down. The story has been watered down. I think part of the reason why you fall in love with a book is because of all the changes of the emotions and stuff. And when you take out subplots, you lose a lot of the reasons for why they're motivated to do certain things. And so I feel like we lose that when you take it to movies sometimes. I mean, my favorite Harry Potter movies were the first two. After that, it started going down for me. But then they took out a lot of the subplot after the first two books, you know, in the movie. So I just feel like a lot of, I mean, for me, even Hunger Games is kind of watered down compared to what I thought the book was. But, you know, the choice of point of view, too, in the book when in first person, you know, the movie, of course, is not in first person. We get to see all the behind the scenes and stuff that you don't get to see in the book. So,
right.
I mean, I don't know.
Well, there is an artistry to doing an adaptation. First of all, there is almost no novel that could be directly, you know, converted to a movie because, you know, books are far more dense in terms of story, plot, characters, and things like that than a movie because it you have the luxury of doing so. With a movie, you don't have that luxury because, you know, essentially you kind of want to hit that magical 90-minute mark. And sometimes all the subplots just don't fit, you know, or some of the material is not appropriate, you know, for whatever reason. I mean, you definitely want to have a PG movie, and if you're talking about, you know, an adult story, sometimes there might be, you know, PG-13 or R-rated material in there, and do you include it, do you not include it, you know, so, I mean, doing an adaptation, you know, doing a screenplay from a book is not an easy task. And the other thing is I just don't think that the quality in Hollywood is there anymore. I mean, that's a personal observation of mine. But I will tell you this. If somebody did a 2001 A Space Odyssey today and tried to put it out there, you would have, you know, even the best critics talking about how bad a movie it was because, you know, in the first 23 minutes there's no dialogue, or, you know, they were using Strauss, you know, classical music, or, you know, whatever complaints you have for people who are adrenaline junkies and can't watch a movie that doesn't have an explosion in it or two. So I think that the trends reflect the culture. You know, culture has changed. The movie-going culture has changed. People go to movies expecting to see things that, you know, maybe when I was growing up were ridiculous. And I don't say that because it's so different. I mean, we had, Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea with the Sea View. We had all kinds of movies with all kinds of action, but I think we had better stories. Maybe it's because people are just lazy. I don't know. I'm hoping that you don't fall victim to any of that. And if you do, I'll tell you. I'll drop you a little note going, why did you do that? No, but you there are so many traps. There are so many, you know. Well, and the other part is if you get a production company or a studio or something who will back you based upon the fact that your books are so popular, the people who pay the bills often mess things up because they don't understand what's going on. So,
I agree. That's kind of why I'm kind of studying the book, the transformation from the book to the movies, is because I want to be true to my books when I get to that point. I don't want to lose what people fall in love with in the books when it goes to movies.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, the biggest one, the biggest disaster was when they took Avatar to a movie, you know. I mean, my son loved the cartoon series, but the movie he hated. And it's because they took one of the main elements of it, he said, they took the fun out of it. Just no, the movie's not fun to watch. The
yeah.
characters aren't having fun. They're all serious, and they're all, you know, it was too serious. And I want to make sure that I want to see those pitfalls before I get to them. You know what I mean? And so,
well,
I
think you're gonna miss some of the crap that you'd have to go through by producing them themselves. You know, yourself.
Yeah.
You know, so of course the big problem for you is where's the money going to come from? Because
mm-hmm.
it does cost money to make a movie. And oftentimes, you know, when you go through the studio system, whatever the studio system decides, whatever the studio decides, you're going to have to do because they're paying the bills.
Right.
So the big thing now is that, I mean, it looks like since you're going to probably self-produce these, then it becomes a money hunt, you know?
Absolutely,
and some
yeah.
people do, yeah, some people do, you know, try to do crowdsourcing and things like that. But, you know, if they're trying to produce a product that nobody knows about, that nobody's heard about, it's going to be a little more difficult. For you, I think it might be easier if your books catch on, you know, for a younger audience. And you may even have someone offer to help fund it, you know, based upon the fact that your books are as popular as I believe they're going to be. So, I mean, it'll be interesting to watch, and it'll be an interesting story to have you come back later and tell us about, because, you know, a lot of people at, you know, the BlackScienceFictionSociety.com website, they are all kinds of creators, and,
yeah.
you know, some do comic books, and some do novels, and some do movies, you know, one of the universal things is it takes money to make money in terms of, you know, either putting together a marketing program or getting the word out, or, you know, because, you know, everybody talks about, oh, you know, you got to get on Facebook. And I'm going, oh, gee, so my 281 friends, I'm supposed to provide a beat down to my 281 friends who already know I need money for this movie and keep hassling, you know, so there's only so many times you can go to the same well. And that's what makes it a little difficult to get wider distribution. Have you thought about the ways, I mean, it sounds like you're kind of on your way with the libraries getting interested and maybe even getting into schools, but have you thought about, you know, increasing your visibility, I mean, from a business perspective?
Oh, yes. I mean, that's one of the biggest challenges, is just getting out there. I mean, I've been... You know, of course, you want to get out there. So when somebody asks you to be a part of something, you just. I've been in a magazine. I was in a, you know, MBE magazine, and
uh-huh.
so just getting in that helps get exposure to the business world. But yeah, just trying to get people to notice that I'm here is a big challenge. I mean, it's cool to go to the events because the people at the events see you, and when you go to the festivals and stuff, people will come up just to see what you're doing. And it's an easy
right.
way to sell books when they see your books and stuff. But the wide audience is still trying to reach it. I mean, I'm hoping
that
animations will help. Yeah, I'm hoping the animations will help. One of the reasons why I want to go on and start putting some short animations out there, because I think if people see the characters come to life, they might gravitate a little bit more to them. But, yeah.
And actually, that'll also help you in the money hunt, because – What people don't, you know, realize is if you can show somebody an example of what you're going to do, then they know what the money is going to go to, you know, what it's going to pay for.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of people will do, you know, try to do a funding campaign for X, Y, or Z, and don't give the people who would be in the audience who might be an affinity funder an idea of what they're looking for, you know, an idea of where the money is going, an idea of how it's going to be spent and what the final result is going to be. You know, people just say, well, I'm doing I want to do this movie, I want to do this, and there's nothing to show for it. So I mean, fortunately for you, you've got the books. You go, well, I am bringing these books to the screen. You know, whether it be movie, whether it be, you know, even maybe the TV show or whatever, but to show somebody exactly what their money's paying for is something that people lose sight of. You know, they go, well, it's perfectly obvious to me. I know what I want to do because they're obviously familiar with their own concept.
Right.
And here you are, you're going and you're getting your drawing skills back together. And once you have your drawing skills where you want them to be, you'll be able to convey to people who can do your animations exactly how you want it to look, how you want it to be. So I it sounds to me like you're on a good path to move all of this forward, to move your art forward and to move your creative universe forward. Are you feeling fairly confident about it yourself, or are you kind of moving ahead with some trepidation about it?
Oh, I'm very sure in the direction that I want to go. I know exactly what I want to do. The different places, you know, like, I don't know if you know, YouTube has got paid subscriptions now. So if you get 10,000 subscribers, I think you can turn it into a paid channel and stuff. So there's a lot more options for me. And so it's about which option to go. Do I want to build up a YouTube following and then turn it into a paid subscription to where I can put out animations through that until I build it up? Or if I want to go local TV and get my show on local, you know, because, you know, you got options in that way. But I know where I'm going. It's just about where I'm going to be, you know, which direction my distribution is going to end up at.
Right.
Yeah.
And then not only that, but you also know exactly, you know, where your stories are going, when, you know, how your storylines, it sounds to me that you're studying on exactly how your storylines will convert to animation. You know, how is that going to work? Because obviously you can't tell the exact same story in a book that you could tell in a movie.
Right.
So your study is important too. I mean, it really sounds like you've got this whole thing wired.
Yeah, I guess because I know I started out knowing where I was going. I'm trying to build all the pieces up. You know, I knew from the very beginning that if I was going to do this, I was going to animation with it. That was the goal, is to get to animation. I love animation, and I always wanted to, you know, be in that world of animation. So I always knew that when I write, they have to be able to convert over. And, you know, making them come to life was part of it. I study sound, you know. My daughter probably knows more soundtrack music than most kids her age because I'm always listening to it. I'm always listening to sound and how to bring it to life. You know, I try to study every aspect because I am trying to do, you know, produce, you know, to build a company that is also putting out books, audio books, you know, whatever collateral T-shirts and stuff there might be, and then taking it into animation to where one day, when kids come to Worlds Discover, they're going to be able to see multiple worlds and multiple layers. You know what I mean? And
sure.
So that's why I'm not staying with the one age group. 4 to 8 is to get people introduced to the books. We're going to 9 to 12 to continue them in the world of Worlds Discover, and then maybe even some YA before they go out and go into, you know, to the adult dramas. So I got a little plan in my head about how I want it structured.
Yeah, people who fail to plan to fail. You know, it's trite, but it's true.
Right.
A lot of people don't look ahead. And speaking of that, let's kind of take a stroll into the future here. And where do you think you might be 5 years from now? So if you come on the show 5 years from now, what do you think we're going to be talking about?
The first animated series, I hope. I mean, that's the goal. I mean, the first animated series.
Uh-huh.
I mean, my first animated series, mind you, I hope it's 10 to 15 minute episodes. You know what I mean? So we're not talking about full-length series. I would love to start off with some 5 to 10 minute episodes of Talie, maybe 5 to 6 episodes in a series. Yeah, I would love to be able to be doing that in 5 years. Absolutely.
And are you dead set on trying to do, like, I mean, when you talk about an animated series and when you talk about shorts like that, are you talking about maybe, are you talking web-based, or do you think you're going to try to get maybe some a television show out of this? How do you think this is going to be structured for people to see it?
web-based. I mean, with Netflix doing their own online stuff, and then, you know, I absolutely feel like if I can get start web-based, then I'll have somewhere to go to. You know what I mean? I think the web is going to help me build the awareness. And because I eventually would love them to be 30-minute episodes, you know, 24 minutes with commercials, 30 minutes. That would be the end goal for each series, but to start off with 5 to 10 minute shorts. But, yeah, I would love to start off 5 to 10 minute shorts on the web, and then if we get picked up or whatever, go to the full 30-minute episodes and actually do a full-blown-out series. So, web-based first,
And then, you know, once you build up a viewership, it becomes easier because, of course, everybody's screaming for content. Someone mentioned once, are you aware that Nickelodeon and the Cartoon Network are always looking for new, you know, animation ideas from the public, essentially what we would consider amateurs. But the fact of the matter is, once you build a popular following, and you can show a certain amount of traffic, people are going to jump on it and say, well, you know, we've got low-hanging fruit in terms of an audience. Why don't we go ahead and convert this to a, you know, a series, maybe even put it on television? You know, is that something that you would be looking for? That's the A part of the question. The B part of the question is, if somebody comes to you and says, hey, we like what you've done. You've done a great job of doing this, that, and the other thing. We would like to buy your intellectual property from you and take it off your hands and move it in, you know, whatever direction we want to go. How are you going to feel about that? Are you really proprietary about your intellectual property and you want to hang on to it? Or do you think, you know, like many people do, yeah, sure, take this because I can always create something else new?
I would love to be picked up. You know, there would be, you know, somebody pick up the series and we can develop it or whatever. I almost would love to rather have the series in development and have somebody, you know, buy the rights to show it for however long or whatever. I'd rather do it that way, but picked up would be great too. I've actually had somebody offer to shop my ideas, and the contract was going to have it that I would have no final say in the production of the story. So, oh, absolutely say no.
Hollywood is like that. When they buy an option, you know, they go, oh, this is a great idea. Look at how many people like it. Let's get an option from it. And then once they get the rights from you, the first thing they do is screw it up because, you know, they're just convinced that they know more about taking something that you did that became popular because of the way you put it together. And then, you know, it's a lot like getting an editor when you're a novel writer. You know, in a lot of cases, when you're assigned an editor from some of the bigger publishing companies, they want to suggest so many changes so they could kind of like, and excuse the crudeness of the expression, so they can kind of pee on it and make it partly theirs. And that's, I mean, it's a tough thing to watch happen when someone's editing your stuff, but the worst part is when somebody buys an option for your intellectual property and then they turn it into something that's just completely unrecognizable that you would never have done yourself, and there isn't a darn thing you can do about it.
Right.
So it sounds like you're going to try to retain your intellectual property so that your worlds don't get sullied.
Right. But also, World Discovered, the reason why it's named is this, because the idea in my head was I was going to have a lot of characters in a lot of different worlds, and I wanted people to come to discover them. That's how my name came about. And so I can't see selling off any of them because then it breaks up my world. You know what I mean? Like,
right. Oh, sure.
And so I see it as one. Even though there are different storylines and different locations, I see it as world, as part of the world, you know, the population of my world. So,
yeah. It's tough, though. I mean, if somebody came to me and said, here, we'll give you $30 million, and I just pulled that out of my, you know, we'll give you $30 million because we want to option your Dark Side trilogy. And I will tell you, you know, the first thing that will come to my head was, oh, $30 million, well, that's like end-of-life money. That'll take care of me for the rest of my life. And then secondarily, I would think, but what if they turn it into garbage? You know, and then So, I mean, that's always a tough question. I mean, hopefully I'll be lucky enough to have to face that problem. You know, I think we all would love to. I mean, you know the woman who wrote, I think it was a woman who wrote the story Horse Whisperer, that what's his name, Robert Redford turned into a movie. I think the story on the street is that she got an $8 million option from Redford before she was even done writing the book.
Oh, wow.
That's tough money to turn down.
Mm-hmm.
I'll be honest
agree.
With you. I could do a lot of things with $8 million, and most of them legal. So, you know, you would have to say, I'm just being honest. I mean, that's a lot of money. And then you go, well, am I going to stand on my artistic integrity because they're going to take my black folks on the moon and turn them into a multiracial group, blah, 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 blah? Or am I going to take the money and then when they mess it all up, I get to badmouth them? And it is a tough decision. But I think that what you've got, and because of the talents you have in animating and everything, you've already got the skills. You've already got the vision of exactly where your universe is going. I really think that you're going to be fine because one of the things that, I mean, the only thing you have to do is make sure that your world, your vision is translated well, you
right.
know,
mm-hmm.
and with only that to worry about, it seems like there's a lot less for you to have to face, you know, business-wise in terms of making the decisions that you're going to make, you know?
Right. Yeah. I mean, I definitely have a good vision of where to go and how to get there. Money is definitely going to be the option, you know, the obstacle that I'm going to have to conquer, the biggest one anyway. But I'm really comfortable in my path. You know, I've had people hypothetically come to me and be like, you know, my husband be like, if somebody came and said they'll give you $5 million for your stories, you're going to sell it? And I'd be like, no, I think I can get there on my own. I have the belief that I can get there. It might take a lot longer. It might not be as big.
Mm-hmm.
But I've never been one to chase money. I've been offered jobs in the graphic design world to where, name your salary. I want you to come to work. And I'm like, I don't want to go work there. I've turned down jobs. And they'd be like, tell me what you want to get paid. I've named my price at jobs to get hired.
Yeah.
So I'm like, in my life, I need to be happy. And if I'm not happy, then, you know, that's my driver. And I'm doing these because I want to be happy. And so I've actually not wanted to work with illustrators because I'm like, you're going to make me miserable doing something I want to have fun doing. And so,
right.
I don't know. It would be a hard one for me because part of me would be like, oh, we could definitely use the money, but part of me is like, I wouldn't be happy. So I don't know. It would be a tough one. But
yeah,
I hope,
it always is. I mean, you know, you look at the Cinderella story of J.K. Rowling, you know, because you were talking about Harry Potter. You know, she at one time she's what, living in her car? And she goes from living in her car to where she is now, you know, where she has to have people keep folks off her lawn.
Right.
You know, so, I mean, like you said, it's a lot to think about.
Right.
And I'll be honest, when I wrote my first book, I started paying attention to what my life was like, just in case it changes, just in case all of a sudden somebody says, ooh, this is great, and you know, things change for me because I do want to be mindful of kind of where I came from and even more mindful of where I'm going to go. It sounds like you're also at that point, too. The money's not just going to change your, you know, turn your head, but it has to be for the right reason and it has to work out right for you, correct?
Right, right, yeah. It'll have to be the right turn, yeah. Definitely,
yeah.
I mean, it'll be interesting. I feel like I would love for the option to come up one day.
Just to see
how I would deal with it. It would be very interesting to be posed that question in real life and have to make a decision. But, I don't know which way I would go. But part of me is like, if it didn't feel right, I probably wouldn't do it. I mean, I know, I love Chappelle. I think he's a great comedian, and he walked away from $50 million. And people are like, how can you walk away from a $50 million deal? He's like, because it wouldn't make me happy. And I understand
right.
it. You know, most people are like, you're crazy, you're crazy. And I'm like, it's a crazy move, but I understand it.
Well, it's funny because, you know, a lot of people, you know, that kind of broke down along racial lines too, because mm-hmm. most people who thought he was crazy were white, you know, and most people who said, I know how it is when somebody tries to pressure you, blah, blah, you know, I think we understood it a lot more because, you know, when you hear his explanation about the fact that he wasn't going to be his own boss and it wasn't fun anymore. And, you know, not a lot of people these days have a job that's fun. A lot of people are taking subsistence level jobs because that's what they have to do. And to have the luxury of being able to say no to that kind of money, that's a pretty cool thing. But it doesn't happen to very many people.
Right.
I think you doing a webisode is going to be great because what it does is it makes your work accessible to everybody who has, you know, broadband coverage. And now more and more and more people have that. And one of the ways that a lot of digital content is being delivered to you know, young or not, I don't want to say young adults. Let's say teenagers. You know, a lot of content is being sent, you know, to their mobile devices because they are becoming the communications hub for them. So your work being, you know, web-based is something that's going to be very accessible to your reading group, to your audience. It sounds like, okay, you may not get rich tomorrow, but what you're doing is if you're pushing out good content, I think that the rest follows. You know, the interest follows. The building up your audience follows.
The base, yeah. I agree.
That's
definitely. I don't know if you've got any small kids that you're around, but even the digital books are changing. I mean, Apple has a program to where you can build your own digital books, and you can insert animation into the books along with, you know, audio, storytelling, and everything. So, I mean, the door of options has vastly grown in the last 5 years. On what you can do with material. So you can take a book like mine, an early reader chapter book, it's in a physical form. Also have a coloring book adventure where each illustration is a, you know, tells the journey of her, there's a picture of her journey. So the book, the coloring book itself is a story. But if you can take it in, I can take it into iBooks and create a whole visual digital book to have it come to life through animation and sound. And, you know, it's just a lot of options now. So I'm excited because I feel like there's a lot of different ways I can go about it. And I'm looking at all of them. Like, I don't have any small kids at home, but I got a lot of, you know, digital children's books on my iPad. You know, just to look at them, dissect how they've been put together.
That's true, and look how many kids these days, and when I talk about kids, we're talking about two-year-olds, you know, who are being given, you know, tablets, iPads, what have you, to play with, and having content on them is a natural now for them to be delivered to, you know. If you have stories, if you have, you know, an animated series, you know, a four-year-old, five-year-old, six-year-old, whatever, it's completely accessible to them.
And I've done it a fun way.
Absolutely. And you know, where in my generation, parents babysat their kids by sticking them in front of television, you know, in their little, not the crib, whatever, the playpen or, you know, whatever they were in, and use the television to kind of mesmerize them and keep them visually occupied. Now they're just handing them a tablet. And, you know, there's books, there's games, there's – I got so mad this one, like, four-year-old girl was, like, whipping my butt at Angry Birds. In my own defense, I never played it before, but she's just flipping them big pigs and the birds at the pigs. And I'm going, what the, how did she get this good? And then, you know, her mom, who's a friend of mine, said, well, you know, she's been playing it on the Kindle for, you know, whenever it first came out. So here you have someone who, is not, you know, really a reader yet, being digital savvy in that way.
Yeah.
And if you're providing an animated series, man, this I think this is going to take off for you. I really think this is going to do well for you.
Well,
I really look forward to your success.
Thank you.
Well, no, I mean, you know, you deserve it. When you look at your content, when you look at your artwork, what you're doing is you're bringing something to our kids that I think is laudable, and I think it's a product that hopefully will sustain, you know, some education, some broadening of the imagination, the horizons, and all of the things that you hope a book brings to your children. So,
yeah.
I mean, with that said, this is it looks like you have nowhere to go but up unless you decide to retire. A little bit, you know, down the road, you know, let's say a year from now, if you have, you know, any of your episodes on, you know, that have been published, or you've done the animation, you know, you've figured out the tools, done what you want to do, we definitely have to have you back so that we could revisit the, you know, the way you've managed your, you know, kind of like the business model of your creativity.
Okay, definitely.
So I'm looking forward to that. I'm sorry?
I would love to.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Is there anything more about what you're doing and how you're doing it that you would like to share with the audience? We've got about 3 or 4 minutes left.
I mean, does anybody have any questions? I mean,
let's see.
I think we covered it. I mean,
I think we did too. I mean, mostly it's just a matter of you sticking with your plan, because
yeah.
It does seem very well thought out. And that's something, I mean, if you have any advice for people on the business part of it, it seems like you've picked a way, you know, if you have to do your own book fulfillment, that's always difficult. I chose a print-on-demand company that does all of that for me. They send the books to
okay.
Amazon. They do all of that stuff for me. And although I don't make as much per book, I also don't have to sit in my basement, you know, licking stamps and stuff like that. So, I mean, that makes more time for me creatively, and that's important to me. In your day, tell us a little bit about your day. You get up in the morning. Do you write? You know, just real quickly, kind of let us know what kind of a day in the life of you as a creative is like.
Most days I get up and I'll get on a computer. Some days are writing days. I feel like, you know, I hear the characters in my head and I got to get them out.
Uh-huh.
Some days lately it's been a lot of drawing and coloring, just because I got to get to a point where I'm putting out books, and that's the one element I'm missing is the illustration part of it. So I spend a lot
mm-hmm.
of time on just practicing different types of illustrations. Some of them I'll put up on Instagram or something like that, Google+. Sometimes I don't. But it's just every day I want to get up and just do something toward my goal, whether it be
mm-hmm.
writing or whether it be drawing, whether it be getting on some blogs and stuff. I don't do the internet as much as I used to, because
mm-hmm.
it was taking a lot of time, so I kind of stopped for a while. But I still watch series and book. Like, I got Crunchyroll for the first time, subscription to Crunchyroll. I don't know if you ever heard of it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's an anime channel from Japan, you know, out of Japan. And so all the
mm-hmm,
anime
mm-hmm.
is on this one channel. We have an Apple box. So I could sit in my bedroom and just watch the whole series back to back. Of course, you know, Crunchyroll is not dubbed, so you got to read the subtitles. But I'm learning, I'm introduced to a whole new world of storytelling. And so
uh-huh.
I'll watch, you know, I just started watching Full Metal Alchemist just because I wanted to see the two stories. You know, I don't know if you know anything about it, but there's the author version, which is Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood, and then there's just Full Metal Alchemist from the producer story, you know, who told the story. They have the same characters, but they go in very different storylines. And so I'm watching it to see how each one handled it, to see which one I like better, you know what I mean? So I do a lot of
right.
I do a lot of watching arcs of stories through, you know, TV shows and stuff. So I'm
yeah.
always working towards something.
Well, and again, you're treating your art and your whole artistic universe as a full-time job. you know, both the creation and the management of your skill sets and the growing of your skill sets. We are just about out of time. We are out of time. I want to thank you for being here and sharing your time. Somebody does want to know, what's your favorite TV show currently? Do you have one?
I don't know if I have a favorite, but I'll watch Revolution. I'll watch Almost Human. Sci-fi, I'm really a big sci-fi fan, even though my books aren't necessarily sci-fi. You know, I really want, you know, Continuum. I hope it comes back on. I was getting into that. I really, you know, I don't know. Sci-fi, you know, Star Trek is probably my overall best TV series ever. I'm a big Trekkie. You know, I still watch episodes, even though I've seen it all the way through from beginning to end. And so sci-fi, I love sci-fi TV shows. So
that's great.
Yeah.
I know a lot of good sci-fi.
I do like the Clone Wars.
Later. Okay. Oh, did you really? Yeah?
Yeah, well, I think somebody said, do you like the Clone Wars? Yeah, like, you know, Star Wars, Clone Wars,
Yeah. All righty. Well, look, I want to thank you for spending time with us. And like I said, I do wish you the best in the future, because I think it's going to happen. You've got such a great world that you've created, and it would be a damn shame if kids did not get to partake in it, share in it, and see something, you know, that is so well written for them, and even well illustrated, because that makes a big difference too, because even the illustrations help their creative mind, you know, take off.
So
I want to remind people that this show is on every Friday at 9 p.m. Eastern, and fall the clock through your own time zone, including, you know, all the way in Kenya, Africa. And I want to thank everybody who listened live, and those people who picked this up as a podcast. Please tell your friends about it. Please tell, you know, people to support the show, because we're doing something at BlackScienceFictionSociety.com that's really not being done anyplace else. And that's it for me. On behalf of the show, I'm going to say goodnight, and I'm going to turn it over to our peerless leader, Jarvis Sheffield.
Thank you, William. I couldn't have stated it better. Just want to reiterate to thank everyone for your continued support. We've been doing this for 6 years now, planting seeds, with the website, with the radio show, with the magazine, with the book series, and now the 3D animated movie that we're working on. Please continue to support us, and we'll continue to support you and try to share everything that we find that's great, like this lady tonight. She's wonderful. I've been sitting here just in amazement, and I want to thank you, Jaquetta, for coming on and sharing your knowledge and your experience with us. Everybody was engaged, and it was a lot of really great information. And I just want to ask you, if you get an opportunity, please drop more information about what you're doing on the site, on the events calendar, your videos. I saw some of your videos. They're awesome. I can't wait to see more. And your new characters, whatever you're doing, please drop it on the site so that we can support you. I know there are a lot of people that didn't know that you did the things that you're doing, including myself, with a lot of the stuff. So please share that stuff with us on the site so that we can support you.
I will. Thank you. And I really appreciate you having me on. Really appreciate the opportunity to talk.
Oh, it's our pleasure.
Absolutely. And hang on after the recording stops, and we'll do a quick chat. And I guess on behalf of the show and everybody who makes BlackScienceFictionSociety.com the very cool gathering place that it is, I want to thank everybody for showing up and wish everybody a great week ahead of you.
Awesome. Bye-bye.